Now we're going to sort of switch gears entirely and call up our wonderful patient panel. So Laurel Carlson and Annie, I will probably butcher your last name again, even though I know how to say this. Kubasarian. Hopefully I didn't do so. There's Annie back there. And Kelly Bugatz. So we're going to ask the three ladies to come up along with Tina Collins from our team. And they're all going to share a little bit about their stories and give you a perspective from the patient's view versus from the physician's view. And then we're going to talk a little bit about our kind of new program and process of creating local networking groups. So I'm going to give you this mic. Once we get all the ladies up here and get them situated. And so you guys going to do that? Okay. Which mic would you prefer? You want this one?
There you go. It's on and it's red.
It's on and it's red, and you're good to go.
I'm the community development manager for CLF, and what I'd like to do is, I know Susan introduced our panel, but they're going to just talk briefly a little bit about their journey, and then we're going to talk a little bit about our networking groups. So Laurel Carlson will take it away, I guess.
Okay. I was thinking I might start out by asking, is there anyone here today who this is the first time that you've ever been in the company of another person with your disease? Is there anyone? Okay, so I was in your shoes for about 20 years that I had the disease and never met another person, never saw another person, never talked to another person with the disease. I was diagnosed in the early 80s before internet, and there's enough of you here that are kind of close in age that I know you can relate to that period of time when if you would have gotten information, you would have felt very alone, which is what I felt. It was at least 15 years before I found another person, and that was only because Judy Jones started the listserv. And I can't tell you how revealing and what a wonderful feeling it was to finally talk to someone else who had my disease, even if it was, you know, on a listserv. And eventually, I found the foundation several years later, was able to attend a patient event like this, much smaller in my area, and met other people from the area. But I had had a personal goal from the onset that I really would like to create some way for patients to be able to connect with each other. I spent, you know, like I said, the better part of 20 years living alone with a disease that no one understood. I couldn't really talk to anyone about it. I made the mistake of joining a cancer group once briefly, and everyone that was there had something, you know, much more complicated than mine, and I felt very frivolous trying to explain to people what I had. So I learned very on that it was a big mistake to try to hone in on another cancer group. So I had sort of a selfish motive, I guess, to starting a patient networking group in the Washington, D.C. area, and I was thrilled with the response that I received with patients that basically felt, you know, that they needed an opportunity to speak to other people with the disease. So it was a personal, you know, kind of a selfish, I guess, motive, but as our group has grown and we have a wide variety of patients. We have one of our patients in the audience today who actually has undergone a stem cell transplant. I hope you don't mind me sharing that. But we have people that have had so many different experiences, you know, varied from mine, of course. And every time a new patient shows, it's just wonderful to have so many different life experiences for people to share with one another. So I've learned a lot from the patients, and So I kind of feel now like I have fulfilled a goal personally, but also now I feel like I am able to, you know, I have been instrumental in providing support for people that I didn't have for so many years, because I know the loneliness, I know the desperation, the frustration. When I was diagnosed, one of the doctors said, well, we think about 100 people a year in the United States are diagnosed with this disease. So I was thinking, well, that's like 2 per state, you know. I'd love to meet the other person in Virginia that has it right now, you know. And of course, that was, you know, a ridiculous thought. But I felt the need to speak to someone else and to have a conversation. And so I'm thrilled to be able to be, you know, instrumental in providing conversations between patients. I help arrange for guest speakers, but I really help try to connect people, especially with the foundation. If anyone, you know, has a question, I feel like I don't have a lot of answers. I am not an expert on the disease. I'm far, far from it. But I've listened to enough people, and I've heard enough different people and avenues for help that I help to try to steer people in another direction, because I don't pretend to be able to answer anyone's questions. Fulfilled my personal selfish goal, I guess, but I feel very fortunate to be able to be providing it for other people. So I welcome you all today, and I would love to speak to each and every one of you later at the reception or tomorrow, because I do think it's critical in this disease to have other people to speak with.
Hi, everybody. My name is Aniko Basarian, and I'm the co-leader of the New York Patient Networking Group. My journey started 6 years ago with a rash that wasn't going away, and my dermatologist decided to do a biopsy, and the results came back with stage 1 MF. And of course, at the time, he was trying to explain to me the biopsy results, and it wasn't making sense to me. He was saying cutaneous, T-cell, mycosis fungoids, terms that I had never heard of. Eventually, it all made sense. I got second, third opinions, and I did some reading. I found the foundation, and I got on the listserv, and shared my story with other patients, which was great. As you know, this disease is what we call, some of us call, a lonely disease. Therefore, being able to share with someone what you have, someone who can understand what you really have, is very therapeutic. And after a while, I realized that it was important to find other people who had the same disease and be able to sort of communicate with them. And a fellow patient in New York and I came together and decided to start the local networking group. And with the wonderful help of the foundation and encouragement, we started this group about a year ago, which has been very successful. We have quite a few members who come every month. We have monthly meetings, and we have guest speakers ranging from doctors to nurses to dietitians, and who talk about their expertise. And then we also have speakers on alternative therapies, which seem to be interesting to our group members. And so far, it's been a very rewarding experience. And as some of us say, we kind of lead a secret life with this disease. But when you're out in the open and being able to share your story with others who can really understand what you've been through, it's very therapeutic. And our message is, you're not alone out there. Thank you. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
My name's Kelly Bolgatz, and I, like so many, had, you know, eczema for years and years, at least 6 years that I can recall. where it was getting worse and worse and worse, and I was just treating it with steroids and going to allergists and dermatologists and even false biopsies until February 15, 2015, it came back as CTCL, and then just recently as Sézary. So I'm from Las Vegas, and both of the oncologists that I went to there, I was their only patient. It was very frustrating for me, asking questions they didn't know. There wasn't treatment options there. They just put me on Targretin because that was, I think, the easy option. And I just, you know, like them, felt alone and just wanted to talk to somebody that had this and find out what they've done. You know, who do you see in Las Vegas? So the reached out to the foundation. They are wonderful. They set me up with a flyer to hand out and did a survey to the ones in Las Vegas, and we've only had two meetings. And I know it's going to take more work, but I just feel good. I feel like even if there's not many, it's filling a need that I had just to connect, just to do something, to see what's out there. And if it reaches out to one person, that's good. But the foundation has been fantastic in helping me set it up.
I want to thank these ladies because I'm relatively new to the organization. I've been here for six months. And one of my roles, I have a couple different hats I wear, but it are the networking groups. And the first meeting I went out to was New York. The second one was Washington. And one thing I realized that there is such a need for these kind of groups. People really yearn to come together and share their stories and perhaps gain information, talk to doctors. Many of them have, they bring in doctors or specialists, yoga, meditation, food specialists, and it creates opportunities for our patients to learn and gain information. And I think it's such a vital part of your journey. Just to give you a little bit of background, Laurel actually started, she is a board member, and she started, I think this was your dream, correct? Yes. I think it's one that really evolves and kind of grows with you. And so then we began one in Salt Lake City, Utah, and then New York, and then most recently Las Vegas, Nevada, and then we have one now in Oregon. We are looking to start one in Chicago. We have somebody interested, Sally Baker right here, who would like to run one of these groups. So we have a sign-up sheet back there. If you are interested, want to get involved, if you live in Chicago, or even if you want to do one in your hometown, please reach out to us, because I think there are opportunities. These ladies kind of, everyone's a different kind of networking group. What I love about it, and I think Laurel's the poster child for this, these groups kind of evolve on their own. She doesn't sit down and structure them and say, this is how it's going to be run. The patients run it, and that's what it should be. It's patient-driven. So they come together, and they decide what they need. So we're very fortunate, and we're always looking to grow our networking groups. Along with that, we hope we do some fundraising with that. But again, we really want to make it about the patients. So what I'd like to do is, if anyone has any questions, because we have some wonderful people here who can share their experiences, feel free to ask any question. I don't know if we have another mic or... Yeah. Anybody wants to ask a question of these ladies? I guess I might be able to answer that. The question was, is how do we go about finding patients in the locations? Well, we have a database, and we actually send out a survey. So we'll do this in Chicago. We'll send out a survey asking if anyone's interested. And there's some questions on it, like what time of day are you available, what day of the week. And then we get those surveys back, and we talk to the group leader and try to figure out the best day and time. And then we make those connections with them. Then we send out the first meeting information. We advertise it on our Facebook. We do an e-blast. So we try to get connected. And then our hope is that eventually the group leaders kind of take it from there. And they go into doctors. They go into doctors' offices and they start putting out pamphlets. And these networking groups are great, because what we find as we're going in all these cities is that a lot of the doctors don't know about us. And so we're that far-reaching arm, and we're getting out to those different areas that we, as I think Joe mentioned, our president, we're a team of five. And it's like, we can't possibly get to all those patients. Susan does a wonderful job of traveling all over the country, but this is one more extension of our arm. Did that answer your question? Great. Any other questions? Do you guys want to share anything else that comes to light?
Let's see, my initial guest list was strictly through the foundation, but I've gotten patients from all different areas. Because we meet in a facility that is basically operated by the local hospital, the social worker at the hospital one time was looking for a group for someone and found her way to our group. And that person now is affiliated with the foundation, but didn't have the foundation background to begin with. Another one was, because it's a cancer facility, and she knew she had a cancer, but she had no connection with anyone with the same disease, was in taking yoga or whatever, and she was reading the roster of the meeting times and the groups, and she saw her, and she goes, I have that. So got in touch with me. So we've had a couple of random, ways that people came to us that I wasn't expecting. And then my next thing is always, you need to, get registered with the foundation, because we're a CLF group, and you need to be getting their e-letters and all of that. So I'm still discovering new ways that people are coming through us. But I think that the doctors are a big resource, as Tina was saying, that as she's speaking to doctors and finding out that they're not even aware that we exist. So it's kind of, and the local doctor that I have a close relationship with, who is really the only specialist in the area, we have a really, I scratch my back, your back, and vice versa kind of thing. I send her patients as soon as someone comes to me, and she sends patients to the group as soon as they're newly diagnosed and looking for support. So I've developed a very good relationship with a particular doctor, but I know there's many others in the area that still are seeing people that have no idea. Also, I will say that I stalk Facebook pages. And when, there's a few that have something to do with our disease that individuals or groups have put up. And when someone new speaks, if I can, go and see where they live. And I have found a few that are in the D.C. area. And I will send them a private message and say, I don't mean to be, obtrusive or intrusive, but, we have this group. And I had one that responded. He has yet to show up, but he wants to stay on the mailing list, so he may show up someday. But so I'm getting sneaky in my tactics.
Have anything? Anybody have any other questions or thoughts? I think this is just a great way for people to. I think Laurel said it the best. It's a place where people can share and come together and talk. I've met a lot of new people going to these meetings, and I think they're one of the most inspirational kind of a meeting there is, because it's not, like I said, driven by the foundation. It's driven by the patients, and they come together and they feel relaxed. There are some people that, really don't want anyone else to know. So we're respectful of that, and each group leader really understands that and tries to accommodate those requests. So Again, you'll see us maybe at the reception later on. Feel free to come and talk to us if you have any questions. But thank you so much for joining us these 2 days.
Thank you. Thank you, ladies.